You know, this is where Havlicek stole the ball. This is where Orr flew through the air when he got that goal against St. Louis. You know, this is where Sam Jones picked up the chair when Will Chamberlain came after him. Red got thrown out of all those games. This is where the Beatles played in 64. You know, it's just great things happened here.
It's the house of worship. It's any community's church on the corner or any community school. It's an extension of the family, and it's part of the social fabric.
This building is probably the best known sports arena in North America.
This place has been more than just a building. It really has become an institution.
And in buildings as old as this, you're not just sharing it with the person who sat next to you, but you're sharing that tradition with all the people that sat before you.
It's the history, it's the way it looks, it's the way it smells, it's the way it feels. It's so unique, and it's so wonderful, and anyone with any sense of history and anyone who loves sports would have to love this building.
What's amazing about the garden is as soon as you come in, you know it's special.
I know tourists come in here, and they look up and they look at all these Celtics banners and these Bruins flags, and they get a little overwhelmed.
I have a lot of great memories. I'll always have them. You can't take those away from me, and I'll always have them. And yes, it was a home for many years for me. It was a home I felt real comfortable in.
It really inspired me to be someone special.
You finally made it to the major leagues when you fought a main bout here in Boston Garden.
Boston Garden gave you that energy. And the fans gave it to you. You could live off their energy. The fans were great, and it was something to behold. Really, it was to play here for those years.
It has a heart, and a lot of business enterprises don't have heart. And boy, this old Boston Garden has heart.
I will always love this building when it's nothing more than a pile of rubble. I will be able to sit and talk for hours about memories I had as a participant, a spectator, and a reporter.
You just kind of feel it, you know. You just look up, you look at the banners, and you know that there's been a lot going on in this building.
The Boston Garden is the oldest operating sports and entertainment arena in the country. It's also the winningest, earning the most professional sports championships ever.
I'm not sure whether Boston has defined this building or this building has defined Boston. I think it's a little bit of both. This is Boston. That's all you need to know about the psyche of the community you live in. It's close, it's intense, it's involved, it's unrelenting, it's unforgiving. It's Boston, it's New England.
It was 1927 when Lindbergh made his solo flight across the Atlantic. Babe Ruth hit his 60th home run. Al Capone controlled bootleg liquor, and boxing promoter Tex Rickard broke ground for Boston's newest sports palace. He had envisioned a string of gardens across the country, modeled after his first, New York's venerable Madison Square Garden. Tex had struck a novel deal with the Boston and Maine Railroad to use the air rights above their proposed North Station terminal to build his boxing arena, promising to complete construction in less than a year. Remarkably, he finished on time, spending the extravagant sum of $4 million. He had created what the Boston Globe called the most magnificent sports palace in the world. Boston's Madison Square Garden opened on November 17, 1928, when President Coolidge flicked on the ceremonial light switch from the White House. The first event was the fourth annual American Legion Post Boxing Carnival, featuring a non-title bout between world featherweight champion Andre Routis of France and Dorchester's Dick Honeyboy Finnegan. Years later, Finnegan said, "My manager told me what an honor it was. I didn't realize it at the time. It may have been hard to consider it an honor when the fighters were summoned into the ring by matchmaker Eddie Mack yelling, 'Bring in them bums!'"
Not only was this a great building for a boxer to compete in, but it was a great place to come and watch a fight. The sight lines were designed with the ring being dead center. There are no bad seats in the Boston Garden for boxing.
More than 17,000 patrons attended the much-anticipated unveiling, forcing the doors open early. They were treated to a new arena acclaimed by the Boston Globe as magnificent. No convenience for the comfort of patrons has been spared at the Garden. The ventilating system wafted smoke from cigars and cigarettes quickly to the roof, so that at no time was the view of the ring obscured to the eye of the most distant fan. Finnegan won the opening night bout, but the real winners were the people of Boston. They now had an arena capable of staging any event imaginable, with a uniquely intimate seating arrangement derived from being above a train station. Concerns about gases leaking into the arena from the steam trains below forced the garden to be built up rather than out. This gave the Boston Garden its single greatest feature, unparalleled sight lines, allowing the fans to be closer to the action than any other arena in the country.
You know, the building design was remarkable for 1928. It puts this first row of this balcony 11 rows back from this dasher board. And I stood backstage a number of nights when people like Bono come walking off the stage, and the stage literally comes up to here, and you're almost an arm's length away from the people in the balcony. And Bono walks off and looks at me and he goes, your balcony is shaking, your balcony is shaking. And that's sort of the feeling you got, that they were right on top of you and you were right on top of them.
The way the garden is built, the sight lines are perfect so that nearly every seat in the house, save the obstructed views, which we won't talk about, is a perfect one for the game of hockey.
But what was so impressive about this building is that the fans are on top of you, and you could hear their comments.
A number of years ago, when Wayne Cashman was still playing in his prime here, he fanned on a slap shot. And there was a voice ringing out from the balcony. And I think it was in the balcony at this end of the ice. And the voice said, "What a blazer, Wayne!" And it was just in a dead, still silence. And it was just uproarious. I mean, we all just fell over. It was terrific. About 10 years after that, it was his final game. It was final season. And Jerry Cheevers was coach. I'm now in the press box, right over my shoulder up here. And Cheevers had not been playing Cashman much, and now they're in a playoff game. And suddenly, here comes Cashman over the boards on a shift, and a voice rings out, "Cheevers, have you lost your mind?" I swear to you, it was that same voice.
Orville Kurtenbach, a player for the Boston Bruins quite a few years back. I can remember him saying, after the media had questioned him, why he is getting away to such a slow start. And his response to that was, "I just do not start to play real well for some reason or other until after Christmas." Well, it wasn't long, the next home game after that was printed in the newspapers, the first step that he put on that ice, the whole gallery god started all in unison. You'd think that they had a meeting before, that they hollered, "Jingle bells, jingle bells." They started with jingle bells. You understand? I think that was one of the best things that ever happened. The gallery gods were just great people and down to earth. They were the ones that were the true hard fans, believe me. Great fans.
And I can remember so many times thinking that the garden was full. And the next day when you go to get your money, you get paid off and 6,700 people. I said, "Wait a minute, Sam. I mean, the place was loaded. And you're saying the paid attendance was 6,700? There had to be 12,000 people there last night, 13,909. What happened?" He said, "Well, Joe," he says, "the joint has more holes than Swiss cheese."
When I was a kid, I never paid to come in here. I knew how to get in.
First time I came into the Boston Garden, I snuck in. It was November of 1968 to see Jimi Hendrix, and I snuck in and sat in up there on the second balcony.
Snuck in a number of times. Up behind the second balcony, up where the gallery guards were, fire escape, automatic. Anytime we wanted to go to a Bruins game, he had a secret knock. He went bang, 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 bang. The door opened. Sometimes you had to slip the guy a dollar or two and you were in.
At the Boston Madison Square Garden, the fans have always been a part of the action, even when the building was renamed. After Tex Rickard died in 1929, Ruth Fasano of Dorchester won the Evening Americans contest with the innovative entry, Boston Garden.
The proximity of the fans, the intensity of their emotions, yeah, they were very much involved. And I think a member of the opposition would agree, this is the worst possible place to play.
I know Gretzky used to tell me he used to hate to come into this building to play because it was so small. He never had any room to make some plays. So I think you get an advantage, right, you know, mentally right away when teams know they're coming in here.
When you walked into this building to play against the Boston Bruins, there was a certain fear that you felt just walking into the building, getting ready for the game, the fans, the noise, everything. And I think that that was one, at least worth a goal or two to the Boston Bruins hockey teams.
I think that it has been a tremendous advantage to home teams. I've observed it. You need go no farther than to speak with Larry Bird on that very subject. He passionately believed that the crowd here made a difference in big ball games, and he tried to feed off the energy of that crowd.
And it got very, very loud in here, and it used to vibrate. I can remember being at a Celtics game, a playoff game, where this place was actually moving.
You know, it gets loud. I mean, there's 14,000 fans. It's a small building. Plus, there's the balcony that seems to be right over the ice. And it gets rocking. It gets real loud in here.
This building was constructed, as we well know, for three purposes: for hockey, for indoor track, and for boxing. And it is the greatest hockey building in America.
The first hockey game in the Garden was on November 20th, 1928, before a standing room only crowd of 16,000. The Boston Bruins lost to the Montreal Canadiens 1-0 when a late goal by Dick Clapper was disallowed. That year, an inspired Bruins team won all of its playoff games en route to the Stanley Cup. The Bruins had become the arena's prime attraction. People called the Boston Garden the house that Shore built, referring to hard-nosed defenseman Eddie Shore.
Eddie, you almost owned this Boston Garden, I know, a number of years ago. I recall seeing you play in many a playoff game here in which you just seemed to have the fans just at your fingertips.
Well, I was very fortunate and very lucky to be with the Bruins, and possibly if I wasn't with them, I wouldn't have been with anybody. I likely wouldn't have been good enough.
I did see him in that first game in 1929. The style of hockey was different. There wasn't the forechecking that you have now, so that a defenseman was allowed to wind up behind the goal, get up a full head of steam, and they called him the Edmonton Express, and justifiably. And by the time he hit center ice, he was flying.
In 1933, Shore's intense style of play ended the career of Toronto's ace Bailey when he charged into him, fracturing Bailey's skull. Bailey spent several months in the hospital and never played hockey again. The Bruins donated the next game's proceeds to Bailey's wife in a true demonstration of hockey sportsmanship. Bailey returned later in the year to drop a ceremonial first puck and hug Shore. The Bruins' tough brand of hockey kept the Garden's attendance figures soaring. Management tried to replicate the Bruins' success by booking amateur hockey teams.
Walter Brown, the general manager of the team, looking for events to sponsor, had been the manager of the U.S. Olympic team in 1936. When they came back, he figured, with the Depression and whatnot, here's a chance to keep them occupied. He formed a team called the Olympics. They were hugely successful. They used to play here Sunday afternoon. 16,000 fans would come in. I'd be one of them. You'd pay about 25 cents with a newspaper coupon. Then 16,000 would exit, and then for the Bruins that night, 16,000 would come in.
The Bruins remained contenders throughout the 30s due to the perseverance of four-time MVP Eddie Shore. In one 1935 overtime playoff game, he played 86 of the game's 93 minutes.
That was the year we went 38-39 that we won the Stanley Cup, and that's when Eddie Shore had skated off the ice as soon as the game was over. And the fans would not let. They were so excited about everything, they would not let Frank Calder, who was the president of the National Hockey League at that time, present the trophy to the Boston Bruins until Shore came back on the ice. But when he skated back, well, the ovation that that man received was something else. I can still see it and feel it. The goose pimples just went down your back.
But the Bruins would not have achieved greatness during these years without the Kraut line: Milt Schmidt, Bobby Bauer, and Woody Dumart. They were the first line ever to finish 1-2-3 in National Hockey League scoring.
Milt Schmidt, who to my mind was the epitome of a great, great hockey player. He did everything for the team. He could skate, he could shoot, he could pass, he could check. He had the heart of a lion. He was just a great all-around athlete.
The Kraut line led the Bruins to the finals in 1940 and to a Stanley Cup in 1941. A Bruins dynasty was in the making. It would take a world war to stop them.
Bobby Bauer, Milt Schmidt, and Woody Dumart left to go back to Canada because they were going to fight in World War II, and we were here up in the press section of the Garden seeing them play.
The last game was against the Montreal Canadiens right here in the Boston Gardens, and it was quite an evening. We had a very big night. I think our line got about 8 points that night, I think. And we were not only escorted off the ice after the game, but also by the opposition. And the ovation that we had received from the fans that particular night was something that you will never forget.
It really was the end of an era. The post-war Bruins never achieved the success of earlier teams until the arrival of a boy from Parry Sound, Ontario.
He was only 12 years of age. We went to Gananoque, Ontario to see two players that belonged to us, and when we left that rink, the two players no longer belonged to us, but Bobby Orr did. And because he was only 12 at that time, he was playing with 14 and 15-year-old kids. And all the ability that he had right at that time, there wasn't one of the five that saw him play that night and say, boy, he can't miss.
Boston hockey fans were so hungry for a glimpse of the young man who might take them to a championship that the Bruins owner, Weston Adams, scheduled a minor league game in 1966 to show him off.
And he wanted to show the fans, don't give up. We got some kids coming up. So they had a game here. It was, it was the toughest game I ever played in my life.
I was refereeing here, and there was a play at the net, and Bobby was kind of hovering over his goaltender. And Derek Sanderson, who was playing with Niagara Falls, both of them were Bruins teams, but he was playing with Niagara Falls, and he came up and he cross-checked Bobby across the back, and Bobby just kind of shrugged it off. And I think Derek got upset that he didn't react a little bit more to that, and he turned around and he really whacked him. And of course, a big brawl ensued.
It was just a Donnybrook from start to finish.
Sometime years later, they said, well, why did you do that to Bobby Orr? And he said, hey, when we came down there, the only person they knew in this rink was Bobby Orr, and if I was going to hit someone, it was going to be Bobby Orr. And that's the only way they'd know who I was.
As soon as he reached the NHL's minimum age of 18, Orr joined the Bruins for the 1966-67 season.
I went to my room and opened the door, and there laying on the bed was Johnny Busick. And as soon as I opened the door, I recognized Johnny, and I said, hello, Mr. Busick. And he was my roommate, my first roommate. And he says, you don't call me Mr. Busick, you call me Chief or John. And so that was made me much more comfortable, and that was the first training camp in London, Ontario.
He always had something else he could do, something new, something to surprise us. And sometimes I used to send him off the ice because he'd ruin our practice. No one else could have the puck.
He was an offensive-minded defenseman, and coaches didn't like that. And not many players played like that at that time in the NHL. So if they wanted me to change or they'd asked me to change, it would have been much more difficult for me. But.
Back to Orr. Into the goalpost.
They did tell him to be careful.
He was a tremendous leader, unbelievably fast, revolutionized the game. Like, he never backed up. Like, defensemen used to always back up. Bobby never backed up. He'd skate beside the opponent and talk to you. And then when you let unguarded moment, he'd steal the puck.
I've always said that Bobby Orr was the greatest hockey player I have ever seen play. And if somebody better comes along than Bobby Orr, I hope the good Lord sees fit to keep me on this earth so I could see him.
Flips it in front, but it's blocked by Orr. Moves it around Howe up to Sanderson, back to Orr. All of a sudden, he's got running room. Getting around Harris, moving in, scores! It's 3-2, and Orr has scored a shorthanded goal, his 100th point. That's Bobby Orr's 100th point of the season. No other defenseman in the National Hockey League history has ever done it.
The Bruins were again fortunate to pull off a once-in-a-lifetime trade with Chicago that brought Ken Hodge, Fred Stanfield, and Phil Esposito to Boston. Esposito became the first player in the history of the NHL to score 100 points in a season.
A brilliant move by Phil Esposito.
I don't know anybody had his stamina. I recall a game in Minnesota, and he went through three line changes and still was on the ice, and Bep Goodland's trying to get him off the ice, and power play, shorthanded and regular shift. Greg Shepherd was just going up and down, up and down, now. And Phil, like 7 minutes, he stayed on the ice. Had tremendous staying power. And he loved to win.
And then the Bruins took off. And this is a hockey town. It's probably the best hockey town in the world.
There was a cockiness, there was a swagger to our walk when we walked down the street or into another building or whatever. Yeah, we were the big bad Bruins. We used intimidation as a factor, and we had size and we had guys to back it up, and it was one for all and all for one.
And they're all coming off. Both benches are emptying. Even Cheevers is coming on. And we're going to have a Donnybrook right down below.
Because we fought as a gang. If you were in a fight, you were never in it alone for long. And we fought as a gang. So they put the third man in rule, trying to discourage that.
70 was hard work. Chicago was a tough hockey team. Chicago was a tough hockey team. They had beaten us. They had played close to us. They had played us real tight throughout the year. They had knocked us off. We didn't finish in first place.
The biggest win was beating Chicago to get to the finals to meet St. Louis, because St. Louis was an expansion team, and the Bruins handled them rather easily. But you know, the things you remember are St. Louis trying to desperately, Scotty Bowman, do something to stop Bobby Orr, including putting Jimmy Roberts out to cover him, to cover a defenseman. Never had been done in probably the history of the game. And it backfired tremendously. Busick scored about 3 goals because he was uncovered.
I think the greatest line I ever heard, we were so much better than St. Louis and tougher. And Bobby Plager, they're down 3 games to none and tied after 3 periods, and we were going into overtime. And his line was perfect for the time, and it was one that was printed the most. When the buzzer went to go into overtime, he said, tell the Lions the Christians are ready.
Play underway, the first team to score wins the game.
Here's it was Mother's Day, May the 10th, 1970. Back to his own line to I remember saying to our players, I said, we can all thank our mothers for buying us our first pair of skates many years ago. Sanderson shooting
it into the St. Louis zone. And I think one of the things that probably shocked everybody was that Harry started Sanderson, Westfall, Wayne Carlton, Donnie Orr, Bobby Orr.
Here's Don Orr, a shot. That's blocked by Talbot. Now Sanderson a drive, and that one whistled wide.
So I took a chance, and I got lucky, and it hit me and fell down to my stick, and Derek was still in the corner, and I just moved the puck to Derek in the corner.
I was fortunate enough to be in the right place at the right time, yeah. And Bobby was a give and go, and he just went to the front of the net, and he tossed it home.
And he put a perfect pass on my blade, and as I went across the front of the net, Glenn Hall, the goalie for St. Louis at that time, started to move across. Now, I'd like to tell you that I put the puck up on its edge and I saw his legs open and I slipped it in there, but what I was really doing is just trying to get the puck on net. And as I say, when I was going across, Glenn's legs did open, but I did not see his legs open. I shot the puck towards the net and it did go between his legs.
I was really happy for him. He was the one that deserved to get it.
29 years ago, the Bruins last won a Stanley Cup, and they do it today, much to the delight of a capacity crowd in Boston. There's Gary Cheevers hugging Bobby Orr, the man that scored the goal.
I see that goal a lot, so it helps me remember it.
I still, to this day, when I see Bobby Orr walking, I still say, that's not right. He's supposed to be suspended in air, prone to the ground, because that's the image I will always have of him scoring that goal against the St. Louis Blues to win the Stanley Cup.
When we won it, the fans came on the ice. My father came on the ice. He was at the game on May 10th, 1970. And I had made a deal with him when I was a kid. I was 13 years old. I wanted a pair of tacks. He says, well, if you win the Stanley Cup, I get the ring. I said, okay, Dad. Because at 13, I didn't think I was going to make it. So he said, he jumped over the boards. Come on the ice. And I see this guy coming at me, so I drop a shoulder into him. I clip him a dandy just under the eye. Knock him down on the ice, and look, it's my dad. I said, geez, Dad, sorry. He said, that's the best hit you had all series, he said.
And I was the one that accepted the cup here at Boston Garden, was able to skate around with it, around the garden. In those days, just the captain took the trophy and he skated with it. And I'll tell you, it was so exciting.
He wouldn't give us a cup. Chief took the cup and kept it. Chief was down here so long in last place that we won it. Chief kept the cup. We're chasing him around the ice. It's Chief. It's our turn. No, I got the cup.
And there they go. the Boston Bruins skating off with the Stanley Cup, Johnny Vucic having it high over his head.
Growing up, playing hockey all my life, and my dream to play in the NHL. My dream to be on a Stanley Cup team. As a kid, I can remember the captain of the Montreal Canadiens or the Toronto Maple Leafs skating around their rinks, the Stanley Cup high over their shoulders, and now Johnny Vucic is doing that, and I'm following him around the ice, and that was my dream. So obviously, it was the highlight of my professional career.
All out by New York here, nobody in their net.
In 1972, the Bruins won the Cup in New York. Just when it seemed they might finally achieve status of a sports dynasty, unexpected forces again ripped the team apart.
And then the WHA came along and robbed the team. We lost some great players, and that would have been a dynasty again. So that was kind of interrupted. So the old garden didn't get what she deserved.
I think the most sentimental moment I had, or two of them, was the night that we retired Bobby Orr's number.
Bobby was the type of a player, though, that would never quit. He played when he was injured, and he shouldn't have. That's what shortened his career. Bobby just felt that he could probably do a lot more stuff with one leg than some of our players could do with two legs, and he was right.
Ladies and gentlemen, the players, I don't know what to say. I love you all so much. I spent 10 years here in Boston, and they're the 10 best years of my life. If you were to talk to most athletes that had been around the league, they would say Boston is the place to play.
And the night that Ray Bourque gave his jersey, number seven, to Phil Esposito so it could be retired in the Boston Garden.
They asked me if I mind adding another seven to my jersey and giving up number seven, and I said, not at all. I think that's the right thing to do. But this was maybe 5 hours before the game, so came to the game, wore number seven during warm-up, and came out for the after warm-up for the game, the presentation, all that. And I rip off number seven, and people see that I'm going to be wearing 77. So Phil, for him, I was just happy to make his night that much better. And the crowd just went crazy. It was so much fun to be a part of that.
What this young man did tonight is something that I'll never, ever, ever forget, no matter what happens in my life.
Boston fans have always been thrilled by the Bruins' tradition of tough, hard-hitting, but entertaining teams. Teams that hold a professional sports record with 26 consecutive playoff appearances.
You know, somebody once described them as a lunch pail type team as opposed to a net dashe case. And I think I look for that in the players as much as anything. The skill level of the player sometimes is beyond their control. They have it or they don't. But effort is something you can control. If they give us that, then they're a Bruin.
This is an arena made for hockey. Hockey was made for this arena. The Bruins, with the way they play the game, Harry Sinden, Boston Bruins team, so competitive each night. It's been a perfect marriage.
Somehow, it was amazing how many players get hurt that Saturday night coming into Boston Garden Sunday. We used to call it the garden flu. Pull a groin, slip a back, oops, shoulder, a little hurt, just can't make the trip. They'd play the home game, wouldn't come into Boston Garden, and then they would play Tuesday somewhere. They'd heal in 48 hours. Boom. It's a lot of guys like that.
The Bruins' intense style of hockey earned them a trip back to the Stanley Cup Finals in 1988. But this time, the Garden could not give the Bruins a home ice advantage.
Above the level of the boards on the side, they'd stop the game, and if everybody skated around the ice very swiftly, it would cause enough of a whirl that the fog would lift.
Yes, these guys are going to be so tired after doing this for 10 minutes, they'll never be able to play this game. And you think to yourself, you're sitting in the press box like, where else in the world could this be happening?
Well, it was a playoff game, so crucial, so intense. The Boston Bruins in the finals, and then to have the lights go out.
They had a power outage at Boston Garden, similar to what they experienced at the Forum in Montreal, which seems like a decade ago. But a power outage, we do understand that the emergency and backup lights have come on, but they have stopped the period.
I'll remember that game for a long time, because I think if we go on and win that game, we have a good chance to win Stanley Cup.
It was not to be in 88, but the Bruins have continued their winning tradition into the 90s. They've set a standard of spirited play emulated by local teams that play in the Garden.
Not only have the great professional athletes come in and played here, but this building has opened its arms to all the young athletes, the high school teams, the Tech Tourney, and the high school hockey championships.
Can you imagine, your college team, your high school team coming in here for the first time playing in the Boston Garden? You as a fan are elevated to another level, and these players are elevated too.
And there was a high school hockey playoff game, and Robbie Fatorik was playing for Needham, and he was the superstar of the era. That had to be the biggest crowd I had ever seen at a hockey game. You just couldn't have gotten any more people. And, all these high school kids were sitting in the aisles, right? It just filled the whole place. And I never saw a crowd that big at a hockey game here.
The biggest moments here sometimes are the high school hockey tournament. I remember being present for an Arlington-Norwood final that was epic. It's a mecca for hockey. The Bean Pot, a unique Boston and Boston Garden event. There's nothing like it in America.
What makes the Bean Pot so special is the teams that are associated with it. Harvard, Boston College, Boston University, Northeastern, local schools, major college programs, competing for that one prize to see who's the best in town.
Anyone that's grown up in the Boston area, I think, that's involved with hockey wants to play in the Bean Pot.
This is the date that you mark on the calendar every year where you're going to see people that you may have gone to college with, but you haven't seen for a year or maybe 5 years.
It's one of the last true amateur collegiate events, and I think that's really what makes it so great, too.
Walter Brown was the greatest sportsman and the greatest showman the city of Boston has ever known. At one time or another, he was president of the Garden, the Bruins, the Celtics, and the Boston Athletic Association. Walter is the only person inducted into both the NHL and NBA Halls of Fame.
Walter's father really was the first general manager of the corporation, and Walter succeeded him. And he was a very kind and gentle guy. A very down-to-earth guy.
I used to go in his office after the performances every evening and talk to him about how did he think I looked that night and what did he think I should do. And Walter Brown was a wonderful man who to me was like a second father.
He was the one that that kept me going as far as indoor track competitions. He was my sponsor after I graduated from college. You can't say enough of the man. He was just so generous.
He wasn't out to make $1 million. He was the most amateur professional I ever knew.
Walter Brown was a sportsman,
yeah.
Not only an owner.
Yeah.
He was a sportsman, and he'd cooperate with the promoters, so kids like Tom McNeely and Joe DiNucci and Tony DeMarco and Tommy Collins would have a chance of fighting in the big time.
Walter was particularly innovative in coming up with something that would attract any fans.
Walter rescued the Ice Follies from obscurity and founded the Ice Capades. He also started the Basketball Association of America, the forerunner of the NBA. The Garden's basketball franchise was the Boston Celtics.
Heinsohn tells a story about, how he would negotiate his contract. They would all try and do it when Red wasn't around because Walter was much more generous. It wasn't Red's money, but he guarded it like it was. And Heinsohn said, you know, to try and get Walt when Red was gone. He says, you know, they'd be talking. He said, you'd go into the men's room, you know, standing next door to each other at a couple of urinals, you know. He says, by the time you zipped up, you had it done, you know. That was it, you know. You just talked, what do you want, what's good, that was it. And Ramsey would send a blank contract to Walter Brown every year. Fill in the numbers, and then I'll see you in September. That's how he did it. And he knew that Walter was too honorable a man to stiff him. So he would get what he was worth on, you know, and then some.
I think the Garden is almost a monument to his memory.
In years back, when they used to sell the place out for wrestling, the noise was just... You couldn't talk to the person next to you. They couldn't hear you because the noise was just so loud.
Hey, this is the champion building. The championship matches were held in the Boston Garden. When I was a world's champion, whenever I stepped in here, it was a title match.
The first wrestling match in the Boston Garden was held in January 1929. It attracted a crowd of just more than 20,000. Since then, wrestling has always been a top attraction and a source of spine-tingling entertainment for its fans.
And Bruno's taking the Sheik and he's holding him up and the crowd's going wild and he's spinning him and he's walking towards the cage and the manager's in the cage and tilts the cage and the cage falls on top of Bruno and knocks him out again.
But one time, there was George Steele, the animal George Steele, right in the Boston Garden. And we fought at the ring. I kept hitting him, he kept hitting me. We ended up right at the top stands. Right at the very top, we ended up. Finally, the other wrestlers came in and took us apart. We come back to Boston Garden here in a cage match to keep us in.
They used to have Saturday wrestling on TV. No longer were they just pro wrestlers. They were TV stars. They were on a scale with, like, Jackie Gleason, because they were on TV.
Exhibitions with celebrity athletes are a proven way to fill the Garden seats. Bill Tilden's first professional tennis match was held here in 1931.
This building saw a lot of early days of professional tennis, but one of the nights I remember very much was 1957. Pancho Gonzalez was the king of the tour. He was a tall, dark, fiery Mexican-American, and he was playing against Kenny Rosewall, and it got to be a long, tense match, and the press box used to be up in the second balcony, and we had to get out our typewriters and get started. First edition deadlines. They're still playing this match. Gonzalez was a notably apoplectic guy when he was playing tennis. He heard these typewriters, he went crazy, and he started hitting balls at the press box, and it was like being under fire. You're ducking, they're hitting all over, hand grenades, oh my heavens. We stopped typing. We said, the hell with the deadlines, we want to stay alive.
And Pancho Gonzalez stopped the match at one time, went right into the stands swinging a tennis racket at a fan who had been bothering him during the night. I thought there'd be a riot that night.
So just as Pancho gets there, the guy next to Dr. Brown is Jungle Jim Luskatov, who's the Celtics enforcer. 6'7", he stands up in his seat, and Pancho was about 6'3", but he looks down at Pancho and he said, Pancho, I don't want you to do that. Well, Pancho looked at him and went back to playing tennis. So Luskatov, who's thought of as a basketball hero, was a tennis hero that night, saved Dr. Brown's life.
Football heroes have also played inside the Garden, although the Notre Dame versus College All-Stars game smelled bad for three reasons. It was held on dirt previously used by the rodeo, the promoter promised legends of the sport and delivered unknowns wearing the jerseys of famed players, and then he skipped town with the proceeds. But authentic Olympic gymnasts have wowed Garden crowds with exhibitions of their skill. The Garden has also hosted both indoor baseball and softball.
We read in the paper that Walter Brown was going to have tryouts for a softball team that he was going to sponsor because in the summer there wasn't anything going on in the Garden. So quite a few of us came in and we tried out, and I was fortunate enough to be one of them that was picked. That was in 1939.
They wore uniforms similar to the Olympics hockey team, and they called them the Olympets.
Well, what they did is they took the diamond and they put it on a slant because the Garden is oval-shaped, so that if you were a lefty, as I was, and you pulled the ball, you could very readily hit the ball into the stands and you would get a single. But for the righties, to pull the ball the length of the Garden was quite a trick. And I saw one men's team play in here, and no men ever hit it the length of the Garden.
But the most popular pair of amateur sporting events at the Garden were the Boston Athletic Association and Knights of Columbus track meets.
The BAA was primarily distance runners, but Walter Brown at that particular time and Will Cloney created the BAA indoor circuit.
When I took over the track meet, he said, get the best track meet you can, try not to lose any money. So in about 16 or 18 years that we ran the track meet, we lost money one year when we had a 6-foot snowstorm.
It was always a full house because in those days that was the second biggest meet on the circuit. Millrose Games was the first biggest and the oldest meet, then the BAO was the second. Everybody turned out, packed house all the time.
Well, indoor track here was fabulous because at an indoor track meet, everything is going on at once. A bell is ringing, somebody's running, a guy's running to the pole vault, a guy's going to the high jump, people are warming up here and there.
I'll never forget the night that Bob Richards, who was an Olympic champion, vaulted 15 feet. That was in 1952, I think. No one had ever done that before. The roof, I thought the roof was going off the garden.
At the Knights of Columbus Games in the Boston Garden, the fabulous John Thomas returns to competition in the high jump. 7 feet, half an inch, a new KFC record in his first outing since an injury last March threatened his phenomenal career.
When I came back, this was the first place that I jumped. Fortunately, I jumped 7 feet again and everything was fine. In 1961, we set a world record here.
The track meet was here.
Yeah.
The old AA track meet.
BAA was
there. Knights of Columbus, there's some great events here. But always, when you get back to it, boxing was king. They talk about Caesar's Palace and the MGM Grand today. The Boston Garden has more history in boxing than all those arenas rolled into one.
In 1940, Joe Louis fought Al McCoy for the heavyweight championship of the world. Rocky Marciano defeated Fred Beshear in the Garden. Marvelous Marvin Hagler defended his title twice in front of hometown fans. Almost every major pugilist has left his blood, sweat, and tears in the Garden ring.
World welterweight championship fight. Tony DeMarco, who was the fistic flower of Fleet Street from the North End, fighting Carmen Basilio. DeMarco trying to regain his title, and I never, ever experienced a night like that at the Garden because, as you know, the legal attendance was supposed to be 13,909. Now, the attendance that was announced that night was only 12-something, but the fire marshals were alarmed. The building actually seemed to shake. People, of course, used to sneak into the back doors and things like that. There were probably 20,000 people in here. They were all for DeMarco. I never felt such a crowd, such violence in the crowd without being dangerous. They just wanted Tony to win so badly, and he got knocked out by Carmen Basilio.
I cleaned up here one night when Paul Pender fought Carmen Basilio for the championship, and the place was jammed. Mostly Italians were in for Basilio, justifiably so, and they all know me because I never miss a boxing night. So they'd come over and say, well, what about your boy Pender? Because Paul and I were very close, very close. I said, well, I think he's gonna win. Put up the money. Put up the money.
He looked like he had been hit by a truck, Basilio. And I can remember thinking, watching that fight, that no human being could stand up. I mean, he was punching the guy so hard. And I don't think the guy could raise his arms above his shoulders after the fourth or fifth round.
I covered some great fights here. Paul Pender defeating Ray Robinson was just an outstanding accomplishment, and winning the title, again, a local boy doing well.
Paul Pender, that was a terrific story. He was a Brookline fireman, a good middleweight, but he had bad hands and he would always bust his hands, and somehow he got a title fight in 1960 against Sugar Ray Robinson, I think the greatest fighter of all time, and somehow Pender won the fight. It was one of those Boston decisions, you know, close enough to steal, as they used to say.
I could have probably won the heavyweight championship of the world if it was here in Boston Garden rather than up in Toronto, up in Maple Leafs when I fought Patterson for the title. It was supposed to be here in the Garden, but then the Boxing Commission wouldn't let Patterson bring in his own referee. He could have brought his brother in. I didn't care. I would have been at home in the Garden. It made a big difference.
You missed beating him by this much.
Life is full of misses.
Yeah, near misses.
We're here today, thank God.
Thank God, and we come out of it okay.
Well, my first visit to the Boston Garden was when I was 12 years old, and I was invited to skate in the Memorial Fund skating show, which was dedicated to all the skaters who had been killed in a plane crash. And for me, that was the first time that I had ever skated at the Boston Garden and the first time I had ever seen so many Olympic skaters.
The first time I ever came here was for silver skates, and I was invited to skate an exhibition. I was about 10 and a half, and I thought that was just terrific. And it was pretty awe-inspiring to walk in here and see a packed arena, something the size I had never seen before.
Sonia Henney, for example. Sonia, a lot of young people won't even remember the name, but she was the ice princess. And she came from Norway, and Walter Brown figured there must be some way to get her in here. So he put her on between the periods of a professional hockey game. And then, of course, Sonia opened the door for the ice follies, the ice capades, Nancy Kerrigan, all the great ones who followed.
Ice shows were practically invented at the Garden. From ice chips to ice capades, ice follies to Walt Disney World on ice, and the tour of World Figure Skating Exhibition, virtually every Olympic gold medal winner has graced the Garden's ice.
And the skaters themselves say they love to come to Boston because they feel the fans here really understand what they're doing and they appreciate the skating.
Great skating crowds, the best. When that world tour comes in every year, it's amazing. They fill these seats and it's such an appreciative crowd and they really know they're skating.
Garden ice is used for more than competition and exhibition. Public skating has helped to fill the calendar from the day after the arena opened. An enormous range of events have occupied the building. Due to the tireless effort of the Bull Gang, the floor of the Garden can be transformed quickly into almost any playing surface.
Basically, when we go from hockey to basketball, we bring out a yellow subfloor of 4x8 panels that cover the entire ice surface. After that, we start laying the parquet floor down. There's 264 squares of parquet floor with 988 screws. Each piece is numbered from A1 to V12, and we go right through the alphabet, row by row, number by number. Every piece fits exactly where it was the game before. Nothing's changed around.
During the Depression, the need for inexpensive entertainment spawned events like the annual poultry show, the modern home show, the horse show, the summer carpet show, and a winter sports carnival featuring a 5-story ski jump.
One of the problems was the ski jumpers had to worry about landing in the other second balcony. And Walter got Hannah Schneider, and Walter waved at a $1,000 guarantee in front of him, and Hans came over. But he said he wouldn't jump on that contraption. But then he saw the thing, and he got so excited, he jumped through the whole show.
The Garden has also witnessed many events that seem to go around and around forever. Motorcycle races, midget autos, a 6-day bicycle race, and the roller derby. An endless array of offbeat extravaganzas have entertained us at the Garden.
I'm just as much of a spectator as I am a competitor when I was here, because I used to always go to the basketball games. Never missed the circus, even when I was growing up. You know, I used to borrow people's kids to come to the circus so it wouldn't look like I'd be coming in there by myself.
The circus has been coming to the Garden every year since 1929. That first year, the smell was so bad that Boston and Maine Railroad employees next door were allowed to go home early. However, the show must go on, so generations after generation have thrilled to the acrobatic feats of the greatest show on earth.
You can still smell when the circus was here. The rodeo, I was not here the night the rodeo was here, and Gene Autry was the king of the cowboys, and he might have been overserved before the performance fell off his horse.
The rodeo was a Garden staple for 20 years. Roy Rogers, the Cisco Kid, Gene Autry, and even Rin Tin Tin appeared to put on exhibitions of cowboy skill and hold contests like calf roping, bronco riding, and steer wrestling. Many of the biggest Garden events have aimed to nurture the soul. Cardinal Cushing was installed here. The Jewish community rallied against Nazi oppression. And evangelists like Amy Semple McPherson, Gypsy Smith, and Billy Graham held crusades in the arena. And the all-time Boston Garden attendance record was set by Bishop Sheen's World Mission exhibit in 1953. In Massachusetts, the greatest sport of all may be politics. And the Garden has hosted many political slugfests. On November 6, 1937, James Michael Curley accused his opponent, Leverett Saltonstall, of reactionaryism during a Garden rally. The next night, Saltonstall declared that Curley's public life has become tainted with nauseating scandal. When Franklin Delano Roosevelt's 1940 nationwide whistle-stop tour arrived at the Garden, he declared, "Your boys are not going to be sent to foreign wars." 1 year later, the day after Pearl Harbor, a Bruins game was stopped for 45 minutes to listen to FDR declare war. In 1944, the Garden was packed with 24,000 people when Thomas E. Dewey proclaimed, "President Roosevelt has let the communists capture the Democratic Party." In 1952, Dwight Eisenhower made a nationwide Election Eve television address from the Garden, promising, "I shall, despite the anguished wails of political partisans, go to Korea." The Garden has also hosted one of the 20th century's greatest leaders. The keynote speaker at the MIT mid-century convention was Winston Churchill.
"I have no technical and no university education, and have just had to pick up a few things as I went along."
But for the people of Massachusetts, the most exciting moment in the Garden's political history came at the Election Eve rally of the soon-to-be president, John F. Kennedy.
I was outside the night before John F. Kennedy was elected president of the United States. Couldn't get in the building.
Well, you had every Democrat and his brother in here, and they loved Jack. They really did. They really liked Jack very much.
The Boston Globe said, "The turnout was the biggest and most enthusiastic in Boston's history. An estimated 1 million lined Kennedy's route to the Boston Garden."
I can remember the motorcade coming in, and I can remember him being bathed in the TV lights outside, and thinking, you know, I mean, the guy looked like a movie star. I mean, and you'd look and you'd see, my God, you know, I mean, there's never been anyone more handsome. There's never been anyone more electric. And, you know, people lunging for him to touch him and just have him wave to him. And he was, he moved so elegantly.
Inside the Garden, Kennedy received an 8-minute standing ovation. The next day, the Boston Globe declared, "Boston roared its welcome home to Senator John F. Kennedy last night in the Boston Garden. 25,000 shouting, screaming, stamping, clapping devotees as he delivered his final speech of the 1960 presidential campaign."
I never saw it replicated. And I've been to 1,000 rallies since. I've been to presidential inaugurations. I have never seen, I don't know what the right words are, adjectives, adulation, affection. But there was an intimacy with Kennedy that all we politicians, even long after he died, wished we had, and no one ever really got again. This was the biggest moment of my life. Following morning, I was going to be either elected or defeated for Secretary of State. I was running against Ed Brook. I was 30. My wife was 23. It was a great moment for the two of us. So I said to my wife, as we went out of the car, being escorted out, I said to my wife, "Let's walk home together along the river to Beacon Hill where I lived." My wife says, "I'm not going home. I'm going with Kennedy to Faneuil Hall." That said a lot, and I was married to her.
Politics and music came together at the Garden the day after Martin Luther King was assassinated. James Brown was scheduled to perform, but cities across the country were in flames.
Nobody knew what to do. If you canceled it, they'd riot, and if you held it, they might riot.
It was decided that the show would go on, but we would ask everyone to stay home. And the show would be shown live on Channel 2.
Martin Luther King loved this city, and it's up to our generation to prove his faith in us. So all I ask you tonight is this. So let us look at each other here in the gardens and back at home and pledge that no matter what any other community might do, we in Boston will honor Dr. King in peace. Thank you.
And that night, Boston was one of the few American cities that remained calm.
It was like the old the old church of the community when something went wrong and things like that. For the healing, the town would go to church. Well, for that healing purpose, City of Boston came to the Boston Garden.
Live concerts have always been a major part of Boston Garden entertainment. In 1938, 24,000 people packed the Garden for a jitterbug contest featuring Benny Goodman and Rudy Vallee. Judy Garland sang here to her adoring fans. Elvis rocked the Garden. Pavarotti's tenor soared to the rafters. Liberace, Sinatra, U2, and Bruce Springsteen all performed at the Garden. The Grateful Dead have played the Garden more than any other band in history.
And the goal was, I think if you were a scientist, it was to win the Nobel Prize, and if you were a politician or a senator, you know, to be president of the United States. And for myself and the Giles Band, it was one day if we could only play the Boston Garden.
And the Garden has been an important venue for local bands, particularly two who are enshrined in the Boston Garden Hall of Fame, Aerosmith and the J. Giles Band.
We were getting deeply in debt, the band, and at one point we figured, well, we can't get on the Boston Garden stage, you know, with all this funky equipment that we have. And so what we did was we, you know, all these bands, you know, Led Zeppelin comes in here and they have these big stacks of Marshalls and these big amplifiers, and, you know, we just had these little amps and stuff. So we figured, we got this idea, hey, why don't we just build these, like, big, huge boxes and cover them with these scrims, this cloth, and make it look like real amps. And, like, we'll build, like, you know, 30 of them and stack them all up, and it'd be great. And so what we did is we had these great stacks, and we had these little amplifiers inside, behind it. And so it looked like these huge amps. And we thought it was great, man. You know, we'd get on stage and we'd play, and all of a sudden the spotlights were hit. And what we forgot was that the spotlights were so bright and the scrim was so light that people could see right through the scrim. So everybody knew it was just a fake, but we tried. For us, after touring, you know, year after year, because we were together for 17 years, coming home to the Garden was sort of like the greatest tonic that we could have, and it just was a great rejuvenation for us.
But everyone's favorite story about music at the Garden belongs to the Rolling Stones' 1972 concert.
I think the first time I came into the Garden was for a Rolling Stones show. And what was interesting about that was that the Stones were held up in Providence.
It was foggy that night and they had to fly into Rhode Island, where one of them promptly got arrested.
They got into a dispute and Keith kicked the photographer, and apparently the photographer was a close friend of the local policeman.
Bam! And, you know, police jumped on top of him and hauled him into jail.
And I got a call from Peter Rudge, the manager of the Stones at that time, saying, Don, we've really done it this time. We just got arrested in Rhode Island and there's no way we're going to make it.
And here was the Garden filled to the rafters. Stevie Wonder was playing. Billy Preston was there. And everyone was waiting for the Stones and waiting for the Stones. And 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, no Stones. And everyone's waiting. And 10:30, 11 o'clock, no Stones.
In the meantime, we went out and got Stevie Wonder to stretch his last number, which ran 45 minutes long.
I called the governor of Rhode Island, who I knew slightly. And I told him I had to get the Stones out. I mean, it was, and would he put them in my custody, I guess. He agreed, so I knew before I came over that I had some leeway, but how I was going to play it, I didn't know.
Kevin White came down and appeared, and he was wearing a white shirt, and he rolled up his sleeves and said, oh, I've got to go talk to the audience.
The fellow who introduced me, the MC, I don't know, I've often wanted to see him again. I've never met him since. But he started trying to calm down the crowd with not much success. And then finally he gave me probably the most unique introduction I've ever received. He told the entire audience to shut the f*** up, which was a hell of an opener for a mayor trying to maintain his dignity before a lynching.
He walked out on stage and said, ladies and gentlemen, I understand I'm no replacement for the Rolling Stones. Boo. But my city is in trouble tonight. I have riots in another part of the city. I have to take all the police out of here. Yay! But the Rolling Stones, who were scheduled to land in Boston, were fogged in and had to land in Providence, Rhode Island. And there was this resounding boo.
And then I told them I'd got them out. And then they cheered and chanted my name for about 3 minutes. I then thought of announcing for president or something like that.
And of course we gave updates. Well, they've left Warwick, Rhode Island. They've arrived at the Massachusetts border. They're on their way into Boston. They'll be here in 15 minutes.
The place erupted as if we just won the Stanley Cup.
Not a soul left. And the Stones got on stage. It was probably one of the most brilliant rock and roll shows I ever saw.
Though trouble was averted that night, it took 200 policemen to contain the excitement the night the Beatles hit the stage in 1964. They played a brief 31-minute set. Or did they?
Bill McNamara, the press room guy, claims they didn't sing any songs, that it was all on tape. He says he saw the tapes, yeah.
8 concertgoers were overcome with hysteria, yet the screams were so loud, probably not a single note was heard by anyone in attendance.
But hey, that's rock and roll.
The tradition of basketball in the Garden goes back to 1944, when the high school Tech Tourney moved to the arena.
For those who don't know, the Tech Tourney was the old Eastern Massachusetts tournament. It meant everything around here. It was the equivalent of a state tournament in every other state except Massachusetts.
We used to come in for high school Tech Tourney basketball games. First game would start at 2, and the last game would get over about midnight.
The years that I was at Somerville, I really can honestly say that I can remember very few games that didn't have 13-909.
They used to clear the building out at about 6:30. So we'd go in the men's room, and we'd hide in the stalls. We'd stand on top of the toilet so the ushers couldn't see our feet when they came in. And then we'd be back out for the 7:30 game, and we'd be here until the last game ended.
But I can't tell you how much of a thrill it is for a kid to come in here, and what a great thing it is for any community to be part of it. When it came time to choose a college, the reason I chose Holy Cross, and the main reason, was the fact that Holy Cross was the big-time school here in the area in New England, and they used to play a minimum of 6 to 8 games a year in the Boston Garden.
College basketball, and particularly Holy Cross basketball, was a bigger draw than the Boston Celtics.
We started, of course, in 1946, and I was the fathead that organized the league. They accused me of having all the good players tied up. Well, we played the first season, we finished 36 games in the cellar, so that's how many players I had tied up. But I never lost faith in it, although I must say I came pretty close to it.
In the early days, attendance was so poor that when the Ice Capades and the Celtics were mistakenly booked for the same evening, the Celtics game was started at midnight, and the Garden routinely scheduled doubleheaders featuring the Harlem Globetrotters. The Celtics' fortunes changed in 1950 when Walter Brown hired Arnold Red Auerbach to coach, and Red reluctantly agreed to play local hero Bob Cousy.
Bob Cousy, he's the greatest athlete I ever saw or hope to see.
The Celtics had a great offensive team. They had Bob Cousy, Bill Sharman, who were perennial All-Pros. Cousy had been MVP of the league, so it was not a slouch team. What they were missing were big people that could help on the boards and get the offense going.
The great line, I don't know who said it, Red's playing chess, everybody else is playing checkers. I mean, he figured it all out better than everybody else.
Red Auerbach wanted to get Bill Russell. So Walter called Lester Harrison in Rochester. What can I give you so that you don't take Bill Russell? And they cut a deal, and it was the Ice Capades. So Rochester got the Ice Capades and took Cy Hugo Green with the number one pick in the country. And then Red made the trade with St. Louis, knowing that Russell would be there.
But when Bill Russell showed up, it was quite obvious that he was going to dominate the sport in ways that nobody ever knew a player could dominate the sport. He was a one-of-a-kind rebounder, a one-of-a-century, one-of-a-millennium type of defensive player. Revolutionized the game of basketball.
Russell playing against Syracuse, that was his first game coming back from the Olympics. The center for Syracuse goes for a hook shot. Russell blocks it, grabs the ball, runs the length of the court, and jams it. And that sent a word out to all the rest of the centers in the league. Next time these same centers came around, you saw them before the game warming up out by the top of the key, taking jump shots because Russell took away the hook shots.
And that was his rookie year, and nobody ever came to the games except in the playoffs. But I think that was the game that made people start to believe anyway in the Celtics.
Most exciting game ever played here at the Boston Garden, or in the entire NBA, as a matter of fact. It was a double overtime seventh game. And we played the St. Louis Hawks with the great Bob Pettit, Cliff Hagan, Ed McCauley, and several other great players that are all in the Hall of Fame. And it took two overtimes to beat the St. Louis Hawks.
They established a mystique, because to have a mystique, you got to be a big-time winner. And that's what happened. Well, 8 championships in a row.
I was a junior in high school before they didn't win the thing. I mean, to my knowledge. I mean, it was like a birthright. You know, every spring, you know, the forsythia bloomed and the Celtics won the world championship.
From 1959 through 1966, the Boston Celtics were the most successful team in the history of professional sports. It seemed that the winning would never end until Bob Cousy decided to retire.
I thought Bob Cousy Day in 63 was pretty big. We hadn't seen a big retirement affair, and Cousy was out here in tears, and our heroes aren't supposed to cry, but he was human.
I have been asked many times this year what I will miss most about no longer playing.
The closest the Celtics came to seeing their winning streak end was during the 1965 Eastern Conference Finals against bitter rival Philadelphia.
There used to be a guide wire that would go from the side of that basket right over to the loge on each side. The Celtics were inbounding the ball, and the ball hit the wire. The wire's out of bounds. Only in the Garden could something like that happen and cost the Celtics a championship. Fortunately, there was John Havlicek, who came in to save the day.
Greer is putting the ball on a play. He gets it out deep, and Havlicek steals it over to Stan Jones. Havlicek stole the ball. It's all over. It's all over. Johnny Havlicek is being mobbed by the fans. Johnny Havlicek stole the ball.
Bill Russell became the first black head coach in professional sports when Red retired after the 1966 season. Under Russell, the Celtics reclaimed the title in 1968. In 1969, they demonstrated the power of Celtics pride when an aging team managed to come back from a fourth-place finish to win the NBA championship. A nod to the leprechaun guided Sam Jones' winning shot.
Bill Russell, he won 11 championships in his 13 years of playing with the Celtics. That's simply amazing, and it'll never be duplicated again. But until that all happened, until we created the fans, until we created not just a generation of fans, but several generations of fans, did they truly appreciate what we accomplished.
It may have been the end of one era, but it was the beginning of another. President Red Auerbach was able to rebuild a championship team by 1974. And in 1976, his Celtics played a memorable fifth game in the Garden against Phoenix.
And at the end of the second overtime, John Havlicek makes a shot, a bank shot leading in that seemingly won the game. Everybody ran on the floor, started to celebrate, but the clock had been allowed to go too far. They put 1 second back on the clock. It took a good 12, 15 minutes to clear the floor and come back.
Won't start till it's touched. They'll have to throw it up. Gorher, turnaround, shot in the air. It's good. It's tied again.
I don't believe it.
Who's the hero of the third overtime? Glenn McDonald, almost the last man on the team, playing only because people had fouled out. An exhausting game, 128-126, just a spectacular game. Generally agreed that maybe it was the greatest game in NBA history.
The Celtics won two titles in the 70s, but the winning tradition seemed over at the end of the decade. Then Red made a series of great moves, drafting Larry Bird and Kevin McHale, trading for Robert Parrish, and acquiring Dennis Johnson, Danny Ainge, and ML Carr.
I also remember my first game with the Boston Celtics. I still was going to be a part of those guys that had been up in the rafters, and that to me was a great feeling. Larry Bird was coming. It was the revitalization of the Celtics.
Probably the most emotional game I ever saw, and there were plenty, but emotion, just raw human passion. The seventh game against Philadelphia in 1981.
It looked hopeless, and then Larry Bird and company took over. It was one of the most remarkable things I've ever seen.
They would have this climactic rise from 9 points down. Everything's on the line against hated Philadelphia. Darryl Dawkins takes a shot. Larry Bird gets the rebound. You knew Larry Bird was going to get the rebound. Larry Bird dribbles the length of the court, and he's coming up the court. You say, I know Larry's making this shot. I know Larry's making this shot. Philadelphia scored 1 point on their final 10 possessions. It was one of the great Boston Garden and City of Boston and basketball moments.
A Celtics game at the Garden became the hottest ticket in town. The only thing hotter was the building itself.
Game 5 in the 84 NBA Finals, Celtics-Lakers, is about as hot as I've ever been. And that was the night Kareem had the oxygen mask on, and it was just boiling in here.
That's when this building really rose to the occasion. The building became a very big factor that night, huge factor.
I know when we came in at halftime, you found everybody changing. You found everybody with ice on their head, wet towels, and, you know, ammonia capsules. You know, you're sniffing just to open yourself up and probably to get more oxygen into you.
Ever a building in a circumstance won a ballgame for a team, it was that night in Boston in June of 1984.
The single greatest night, I suppose, that I was here was the 84 finals when they won the seventh game.
Larry Bird against Magic Johnson, Kareem against Chief, Cedric Maxwell in Game 7 saying, jump on my back because I'm going to take you to the promised land.
They may have been a better team on paper, but that night with our Celtics pride, our want, our hunger, we walked away with the championship that night.
And then when we stood out there before in that first game and received those championship rings and pulled it to the rafters, we knew that we were part of something special. And all this happened in this little old place out here. It's amazing.
They went 40-1 here in 1985-86 regular season and won all their postseason games. I don't think we'll see that again. And I got to think that the crowd had something to do with that.
Then any team coming in and you're beating them each time they come to your place, then they are a little leery when the next time they come in. They're intimidated because, oh, geez, we've got to go to the Garden. Wow, and that ugly place and that floor.
The Boston Garden floor was unique. Tiny Archibald told me early on in my career not to try my fancy spin dribbles and behind the backs between the legs too often because I saw a lot of good players turn the ball over many times in the dead spots of the Garden floor.
And to sports fans everywhere, the famed parquet floor became synonymous with success, just as their longtime voice, Johnny Most, became identified with Celtics pride.
He was heart and soul of this basketball team. There's no question about that. We were sitting right up there in that overhang up there one night, and some opposing player got in one of the Celtics' faces, and Johnny Most said, that son of a bitch did that again. I couldn't believe it, right there on WBC radio. Yikes. That was Johnny.
Johnny Most reached his zenith in the 87 series against his most hated Detroit Pistons.
And I'm amazed that no one fell out of their seats and fell right over the balcony. Everyone was jumping up and down. Everyone was hugging each other.
Then there was a seventh game with the Pistons in 87 when Vinnie Johnson clanged heads with Adrian Dantley.
What I remember about that is watching Vinnie Johnson, this guy that killed the Celtics, kind of wobbling off the floor thinking, just looking at his eyes and thinking, this guy's never coming back.
The parquet floor had claimed another victim. Though the Celtics were unable to win any more championships in the Garden, Larry Bird and his teammates continued to thrill their fans with some very entertaining basketball.
Because he gave back to the fans what they came to see. He never cheated them. Larry Bird probably was the perfect player for this building. He was a tough son of a gun. Bird's tough.
I think he hit his head on the floor. Everyone thought he was out for the game, and when he came flying through that tunnel, like Superman, the place just went nuts.
And the roar of the crowd as he came running through that tunnel, that was really something to see.
And of course, the Celtics won the game. I'm kind of glad in a lot of ways that Larry didn't have to play in the new building because this is really where he belonged, and it was where his retirement should have been.
It was one of the most spectacular evenings I have ever spent in this building. The Garden really, really, really put on its prom gown for that night. Shone brightly in one of its proudest moments.
And the greatest moment from that was when Larry went down to raise his banner. I saw Rick Roby like leap out of his chair on the floor, and he had this little Instamatic camera, and he was trying to get over to take pictures of Larry. And just that Rick Roby thought enough of this as a little historic moment, a Kodak moment, if you will. It was very sweet.
Bird's retirement was the end of another great era in Celtics history. When his number was raised to the rafters, it evoked memories of other Celtics greats.
1969, the Celtics are playing home against the Lakers in the NBA Finals, and the announcer says, "And starting at guard from North Carolina State, in his last game ever at Boston Garden," and that's all you could hear, and it was number 24, Sam Jones, and the place just went absolutely bonkers.
I think this crowd, more than any I've ever seen, can appreciate hard work, skill, commitment, and all of the other intangibles of winners.
I think they are a different type of fan. They have assimilated the history of the Boston Celtics. They truly appreciate all that went before.
This is the 49th season of the NBA now, and Red's still here, president of the team. He's the only guy in the history of American sports who can never say that was before my time. I mean, his career covers the entirety of the NBA, because he was there in day one in 46, and he's there today. This, of course, is the only building that spans the entire history of the NBA.
That's quite a thought, to think of saying goodbye to the Boston Garden when all of us have thought how wonderful it is to get there and say hello.
When the day finally comes, when the last gong is sounded and the last roar of the crowd goes out of here, there'll be a few moist eyes.
So when we stand out there knowing it's going to come down, we realize that we really will be a part of history and truly something special.
It's kind of tough to swallow to think that it just won't be here anymore. It's sad.
As the song says, the Irish song, there'll be a tear in my eye, I'm sure, that day.
It's going to be tough. It's going to be very emotional for me. It's part of your life. If you're a sports fan in Boston, grew up here, it's part of your life.
My memory will be more of Walter Brown than it will be of the Garden. That's a very personal, close memory that we had for so many years.
It holds a tremendous amount of memories and tremendous amount of history here for me.
I see my number hanging up there, and I see the Stanley Cup championship team's banners looking up there, and you know, it brings back so many memories.
When the building goes down, then the memories will still remain.
That's really the treasure of having been involved with a place like this for so many years, is memories that you can take with you and never lose.
I met my wife in this building, I broke a kneecap in this building, I played goal against Bobby Orr in this building.
I'll give it, you know, the long look around, and each time I come into this building, I think of many things that happened over the years. And I will do that again the night, that final night.
I'd like to skate around maybe once or twice before they tear this down. It would be something kind of nice.
Before this building is torn down, I want to walk out to the middle of the floor when the parquet is down, and I'm going to kiss the shamrock. Before the ice is melted, I'm going to walk out and I'm going to kiss the big B, and I'm going to look up at the championship banners of the Celtics and the Stanley Cup banners of the Bruins, and I'm going to think I'm one of the luckiest guys around.
For me, it's going to be one of those special buildings that will always exist on this site the Boston Garden stood.
Thanks for the memories. Thanks a lot.